All right, so what we've been talking about are intermolecular forces, and we've mentioned dipole forces, we've mentioned hydrogen bonding, and we've mentioned induced dipole forces, which are also called London dispersion forces. These types of forces are collectively known as van der Waals forces. This is the same guy we saw in our gas chapter. Basically, when you're looking at an ideal gas, when does it behave non-ideally? It's when the particles interact with each other. And what is it that causes the particles to interact with each other? It's these intermolecular forces, these forces of attraction between the particles, the dipole forces, the hydrogen bonding, the London forces, whatever happens to be present. Now, London forces are present in all covalent molecules. They're actually also present in ionic compounds, which we'll talk about in just a minute. It's just that they're not that important in ionic compounds, so usually we don't worry about them in ionic compounds. Dipole forces are present in all covalent molecules that are polar, so these are present in all polar covalent molecules. And hydrogen bonding is present in polar covalent molecules that have the special case of a hydrogen bonded to a nitrogen, oxygen, or fluorine. So if you have a sample of a covalent molecule, you can definitely say there are London forces or London dispersion forces present. If the molecule is polar, you can also say, in addition to the London forces, there are dipole forces. And if the molecule happens to have a hydrogen bonded to either a fluorine, a nitrogen, or an oxygen, you can also say that there is hydrogen bonding present. So a sample might have one of these, it might have all three of these. All samples are going to have these London forces. If you are talking about an ionic substance, let's talk about it for just a minute. These forces are not the forces that we have to deal with in terms of looking at melting something. And I want to focus in on melting something or boiling something, because those are the examples we used when we looked at these van der Waals forces. In order for a gaseous substance to become a liquid, so you're talking about liquid to gas is boiling something, so gas to liquid is condensing something, or if you're talking about a solid going to a liquid, that would be melting, or a liquid going to a solid, we're talking about crystallization. In an ionic compound, the dipole hydrogen bonding and London forces are not what you're talking about. You're talking about attractions between the ions. What causes an ionic compound to be either a solid, a liquid, or a gas? It's the same sorts of things that we looked at before. The particles are close together and held rigidly, it's a solid. If the particles are close together but are able to move, it's a liquid. If the particles are far apart, it's a gas. But in an ionic compound, you have honest to goodness positive charges and negative charges on the ions, and they are very attracted to each other. What makes the world go round is the attraction of positives and negatives. So in an ionic compound, there are strong, strong, strong ionic forces between the ions. We can call them interionic forces, but we might as well just call them ionic forces that keep those particles, the plus particles and the minus particles, the ions, close together. And all ionic compounds are solids at room temperature, because all ionic compounds have very high melting points and incredibly high boiling points. Essentially, what you're looking at is you're looking at needing to raise the temperature a lot. You're needing to give the sample lots and lots and lots and lots of energy to overcome these forces of attraction between the ions. In a covalent compound, you do not have ionic forces. You have intermolecular forces that need to be overcome in order to melt something or boil something. So if you have a covalent compound, we see a wide variety in the melting points and the boiling points depending on which of these forces are present in the molecule. Now, let me point out something that hopefully is very obvious, but you may not have thought about it in a while. In a covalent compound, you do not break covalent bonds in order to melt something or boil something. You do not break covalent bonds. If I want to melt water, a molecule of water that is in the solid state, in order to become liquid, it is still H2O molecules. I have not broken the hydrogen-oxygen covalent bond. What you've done is you've overcome that attraction between the water particles by raising the temperature, providing energy, and so they're able to move further apart because you're overcoming that energy. And if you boil it, then they're able to move even farther apart than in the liquid state. The intermolecular forces still exist. You just have given it enough energy to overcome those forces. But we're not breaking any covalent bonds in order to melt something. You don't break any covalent bonds in order to boil something. All right, let's talk about the strength, the relative strength of these intermolecular forces as compared to other things that we're familiar with. First of all, when it comes to ionic compounds, which remember, that's not what we're talking, we're not talking about dipole, hydrogen bonding, or London forces. The ionic compounds forces, the interionic forces, vary pretty widely, but they're on the order of about 100 kilojoules to even 1,000 kilojoules. The strength of the interionic forces, those forces between the ions, can be very, very large, and this is kilojoules per mole of substance. So we're looking at, in order to overcome the forces of attraction between the positives and negatives, you're looking at having to provide this amount of energy. In a covalent compound, if you want to break a covalent bond, which is not an intermolecular force, you're looking at providing enough energy in the order of hundreds of kilojoules per mole. You may recall from previous chapters, bond strengths are the amount of energy required to break a bond, so you're talking about hundreds of kilojoules per mole in order to break a covalent bond. In order to melt or boil a covalent compound, you do not break the bonds, you simply overcome these intermolecular forces, the dipole and or hydrogen bonding and or London forces. And here you're talking about much, 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 much less energy than the hundreds of kilojoules that it takes to break a covalent bond. So the amount of energy provided to melt or boil a covalent compound is not the amount of energy that it takes to break the bonds, but that's not what we're trying to do. We're trying to melt it or boil it, which is simply to take the particles and move them further away. If we look at roughly a scale in terms of melting or boiling, and I'll use that a lot because it's easy for us to think about. In terms of melting or boiling, the stronger the forces holding the particles together, the higher the melting and boiling point. The stronger the forces holding the particles together, the higher the temperature you're going to need to go to get to your melting or boiling point. And in terms of melting and boiling points, ionic compounds tend to have the highest melting and boiling points. Their melting and boiling points tend to be much, much higher than all covalent compounds, although we do find some covalent compounds that have very, very high melting points. So this is just in general. This is not for everything. We do see exceptions, but in general, ionic compounds tend to have higher boiling points and melting points than covalent compounds. Covalent compounds have a wide range of melting points and boiling points, and it depends on which forces are present. And in general, again, we find some exceptions. Those with hydrogen bonding tend to have the highest melting points and boiling points, higher than those with dipole forces in general, and which is tends to be higher than those with just London forces. However, and we'll see lots of examples of this, compounds with just London forces can actually have higher melting points and boiling points than those with hydrogen bonding, depending on the strength of those London forces. So we see a huge range in melting points and boiling points because there's a huge range in strengths of London forces. But we do see the range. In general, if you're comparing apples to apples, molecules with hydrogen bonding tend to have the highest melting points and boiling points, higher than those with just dipole forces, comparing apples to apples. Comparing apples to apples, those with dipole forces tend to have higher melting points and boiling points than those with just London forces.